So hello everyone, welcome back to the channel Pharmacology Simplified. In today's video, I will be discussing with you about the enzyme ring receptors. These are the class of receptors. One more thing I need to mention in the beginning, it's raining outside and there are some storms going on, so there are chances that you might hear some disturbance during the recording of this video. Right, but I have tried to keep it as quiet as possible. So when we talk about enzyme ring receptors, see, we have already discussed enzymes in previous videos. You can find a link right there. So when we talk about enzyme ring receptors, these are the receptors that work, or when the agonist bind to these receptors, what it does, what those receptors do, they activate intracellular enzymes, and after that these enzymes are actually responsible for bringing out the changes in response to the binding of the ligand, right? These receptors are also called as tyrosine kinase receptors. During the video, I would be referring my notes in between so that I do not miss on any important topic to discuss in this video, right? So when we talk about receptors, let me give you a very brief insight of this. When we talk about receptors, so receptors are cellular macromolecules that provide a binding site to any agonist, to any ligand that can bring about a physiological change in the cell, right? So receptors, they can be present on the surface of the cell, they can be transmembrane, and they can be floating inside the cytosol, or they can be present on the surface of the nucleus, or they may be located inside the nucleus. So receptors can be present anywhere in the cell, on the cell, right? So when we talk about enzyme ring receptors, these receptors, they are primarily of two types. So these are two types of receptors. First are the receptors that are having intrinsic enzymatic activity, and other are those receptors that do not have intrinsic enzymatic activity. So what they do, they recruit several intracellular proteins to bring about the changes, right? So these enzyme ring receptors, they are transmembrane receptors. They have a cytosolic domain. So transmembrane, for example, if we see, this is our plasma membrane, right? So this is the lipid bilayer. So this is the extracellular side, this is the intracellular side. So anything that is present here, this is present on the extracellular, anything that is present inside the cellular, intracellular, and anything that is present like through the membrane will be called as transmembrane. I guess I'm clear with this, right? So let's move ahead and we will discuss these now in detail, right? So these are the three types of receptors. First are our tyrosine kinase receptors. This means these receptors, they phosphorylate the tyrosine residues that are present on the tyrosine kinase. And other, they activate the serine threonine, and the last one we have cytokine receptors. So cytokine receptors, when we are talking about them, these are the receptors that do not have, they do not have intrinsic tyrosine kinase activity, right? So these are the receptors, right? So, if we see the examples of tyrosine kinase receptors, we have the very common example of insulin, right? And for cytokine receptors, we have our interleukins, cytokines. So, they will act through these receptors and several growth factors. They show their actions via activation of, or via phosphorylation of the serine threonine kinases, right? So now let's discuss their mechanism, how these receptors show their activity. So first, I will discuss about the tyrosine kinase receptors. So first, let me explain to you the basic structure of this receptor. So this receptor, it comprises of several different units. So first, as with every receptor we see, first we have the ligand binding site, right? And after this ligand binding site, we have this transmembrane alpha helix. So this is the linking part between the extracellular and the intracellular side of the molecule. Then we have this tyrosine residue, and this is the tyrosine kinase domain, right? So this is actually the enzyme. This is tyrosine kinase, this is the enzyme. This is clearly showing that this is an enzyme which is having a tyrosine residue, and what it will do, it will be actually responsible for the phosphorylation. Phosphorylation of any protein when we talk about, this means that we are activating this, activating any molecule, right? For example, phosphorylation of a channel will lead to the channel activation, or phosphorylation of any enzyme or any protein leads to activation of it, right? So what happens? First, I'll tell you the steps. What are the steps? So first is, the very first step will be the ligand binding. So I would like that you first write down all these points so that I can explain each of the points in detail, one by one. If you want, you can have a screenshot of this also. So now let's see what happens. So first, this is the ligand binding site. So whenever the ligand will bind to this, right, whenever the agonist will bind to this, right? Whenever the ligand will bind to this, there will be dimerization of this. So this will get converted into this stage. So the receptor gets dimerized. And whenever this receptor will get dimerized, there will be a series of events that will lead to the autophosphorylation, right? So what I told in the beginning, that these receptors have the intrinsic tyrosine kinase activity. That means tyrosine kinase, these kinase will activate, or they will phosphorylate the tyrosine residue that is present on the surface of the cell, right? So in the next stage, what will happen? There will be autophosphorylation. So now this is the ligand binding. Next we are having is receptor dimerization. So dimerization is clear, like single unit is monomer, two units are dimer, trimer and polymers. So in the next stage, what will happen? And see, here I have also shown that there are conformational changes after the ligand is bound to the receptor. So now in the next stage, there will be activation, this phosphorylation of the receptors, of the tyrosine residue. Right? So this is phosphorylation of the tyrosine residue. this is autumn. In the next step, now one thing I mentioned in the beginning that there will be activation of other intercellular proteins with SH2 domain, right? So what are SH2, what is SH2 domain and how it plays a role in the activation of this? So let me be very specific about this. For example, this is one protein, this is second protein, this is third protein, right? So now this protein is having SH2 domain, this protein is having SH2 domain, and this protein is not having SH2 domain, right? So this SH2 domain will act as an identifier that where there is activated tyrosine, where there is phosphorylated tyrosine residue, this SH2 will attract this protein to the site. Am I clear? Let me explain it to you once more. This protein that has an SH2 domain, so this SH2 will act as an identifier, or it will act as a sensor towards this phosphorylated tyrosine residue, right? I told in the beginning, this is the tyrosine kinase domain and this is the tyrosine residue, and this tyrosine residue has now been phosphorylated. So after it has been phosphorylated, this tyrosine residue has become an attractive site to this SH2 domain, and now this SH2 domain containing protein will come to this site, and after it comes to this site, there will be activation of this protein, and this protein will be responsible for activation of several other proteins inside the cell. Right? So let's move ahead. So in this case, there is a protein that is called as GRB2 protein, and that has a SH2 domain attached to it. Right? Clear enough? So now when this is, let me say it once more, this is phosphorylated tyrosine residue, right? So now this SH2 will sense this activated, and this will migrate to this site. Now this SH2 domain protein, containing domain protein, will migrate to the this tyrosine kinase. Now what will happen in the next stage? This is same. Now this SH2 protein will go to the site. Now this protein will go there, and this protein is also having a tyrosine residue on this. Right? There is also a tyrosine residue that is present on this protein surface. Now what will happen? This enzyme, since this is a tyrosine kinase enzyme, what it will do? It will also activate the tyrosine residue present on this secondary protein, right? So now when this tyrosine will be activated, now this protein will become itself activated, and it will go to activate some other proteins, right? In this case, I'm taking example of RAS-REF or MAP kinase pathway. RAS is a oncogene. Now let me explain that to you. So RAS, right, and this GRB2, this will go and activate this RAS. And now what it will do, it will in turn activate this RAS, and for this RAS, the substrate is RAF. There will be activation of RAF protein, there will be activation of MEK, then there will be activation of MAP. So there will be phosphorylation, then again there will be phosphorylation, then again there will be phosphorylation, and this MAP kinase will activate transcription factor, right? This MAP will activate transcription factor. Now they will, the
these transcription factors will now migrate to the nucleus, right? They will migrate to the nucleus of the cell, and when they will migrate to the nucleus of the cell, what will happen? That there will be synthesis of like several proteins or gene expression that will take place. So I guess I'm clear with this. If any doubt is there, let me explain this to you this once again. So what is happening here? This is our receptor, right? We are focusing only on this part. So this is our receptor. This is the extracellular domain where it is offering a ligand binding site. Then this is transmembrane alpha helix. Then this is the tyrosine kinase domain with the tyrosine residue on this, right? Whenever there is binding, right? Whenever there is binding of the ligand to the receptor, what happens? There is auto. This is the receptor dimerization. The receptor dimerizes, and when this receptor dimerizes, it leads to the autophosphorylation of the tyrosine residue. So this was the tyrosine residue, and this tyrosine residue was present on this tyrosine kinase domain. Remember, tyrosine kinase. Remember, these receptors are having intrinsic tyrosine kinase activity. They do not require any other protein to activate these tyrosine enzymes, right? These tyrosine residues. So there is autophosphorylation of these tyrosine residues, and once these tyrosine residues have been phosphorylated, now what will happen? There, this activated, this phosphorylated tyrosine residue, this will become a site for these proteins that have SS2 domain. So this SS2 domain is essential for this protein to come and bind to this site. So once this protein will come and bind to this, there will be, since these are tyrosine kinase enzymes, so this protein that already has a tyrosine residue with itself, now this tyrosine residue will be activated, and this protein will detach from here. And after this protein is detached, it will go and bind to another protein. Now this is this protein is named as RAS. This is an oncogene. It plays a role in cancer. So this RAS, and there will be phosphorylation of RAF because this was the substrate for it. Now this RAF will phosphorylate MEK. This MEK will phosphorylate MAP, and then this will activate transcription factor. These transcription factors will migrate to the nucleus, and they will lead to the gene expression. Right? They will lead to regulation of gene expression. Explaining all these is beyond the scope of this module, so I would be restricting myself only to the process and not the actual roles of every of these proteins, right? So now we will have a look at the cytokine receptor, right? Or the receptor that is not having any tyrosine kinase activity associated with it, right? So let us have a look at the structure of this receptor. So this receptor, like the previous one, has the same structure, but the only difference is that it lacks a tyrosine kinase domain, right? Like we have seen in the previous receptor. So this is the ligand binding site. Then we have the transmembrane alpha helix, and then we have the tyrosine residue, not tyrosine domain. This is the tyrosine residue that will be phosphorylated by a tyrosine kinase. And so what I have said, like this is the tyrosine residue without kinase activity. So in order to a ligand, right? In order for a ligand to show its action via these receptors, there it is essential that this tyrosine residue gets phosphorylated, because only after it is phosphorylated there will be phosphorylation of those proteins that have SS2 domain in them, right? Like I have just explained in the previous one. So let's move ahead and in the same cycle. So you may note it down, like what are these, because I'm going to clear them off anyway. So let's see. So whenever there is binding of the ligand, whenever the ligand will bind to this, there will be, what we know, what will happen? There will be dimerization of the receptor. So this receptor will undergo conformational changes, and then the receptor will undergo dimerization. Right? It will undergo dimerization. So after this receptor it gets dimerized, then there will be changes that will attract a tyrosine kinase enzyme that is already present inside the cell, right? In the previous case, the receptor was having, or initially the receptor was having its tyrosine kinase activity, but in this case there will be receptor dimerization, and after the receptor dimerization there will be recruitment of a tyrosine kinase from the cell, right? So in this case the tyrosine kinase will be JAK stands for Janus kinase, J-A-N-U-S kinase. So now what will happen, this will be the next stage will be that there will be recruitment of these this JAK will come and it will phosphorylate. Am I clear? So now there will be phosphorylation of the. So now this receptor is equipped with the tyrosine kinase. Like in the previous state, if you try to derive the similarity between these two receptors, it is very common, right? There, in the previous receptor, there was a tyrosine kinase present and it was activating a tyrosine kinase residue. What difference we had in this one? Like this is a receptor, we had only tyrosine kinase with us, right? We had only tyrosine residue with us, but what we did, we recruited a tyrosine residue, right? Are we on the same page? Okay, so let's move ahead. And now, once this receptor is equipped with the previous state, so in the next stage, I'm just separating it. Right? I'm just separating it for, so I can show you the next stage. In the next stage, what will happen? What we need? We need a protein with SH2 domain. So this will remain the same. So now we will have, right? Now we will have a protein with SH2 domain, and this protein is, in this case, is called as STAT. This has a SH2 domain with it, right? So now, what I told in the previous part of this video, that this SH2 domain will act as an identity marker, or it will act as a sensor, and it will get attracted towards a phosphorylated tyrosine residue, right? So now this STAT will go and it will bind to this. So now there will be binding of two STAT proteins. So there will be one STAT, it will bound to it and it will be phosphorylated, and there will be other STAT that will be bound to this and it will be phosphorylated, right? So now when this STAT and this STAT, right, what they will form? They will form a dimer. So this is STAT and this is STAT. Now they have become a dimer, right? And we know what are dimers.
So these are, now both of them are now phosphorylated, and now this STAT complex, this will migrate to the nucleus, right? Now this will migrate to the nucleus, and where it will regulate gene transcription. So I guess with this we are clear with the physiology of tyrosine kinase receptors. Tyrosine kinase receptors, there are two classes, one with intrinsic tyrosine kinase activities, and the other are the receptors that do not have the intrinsic tyrosine kinase activity. What they do, they recruit proteins like JAK, so that this they can phosphorylate tyrosine residues present on the proteins, right? You can have a screenshot of this, and with this I would like to end up this module. And if you have been able to understand anything out of this, please make sure you subscribe to the channel, share the video as much as possible. You can follow us on Facebook and on Instagram also, we are present, and the link would be in the description below of the video. Happy learning to all of us.